So this particular discussion this evening emanates from two different projects taking place in two different geographies. One is a project that OECD is undertaking for the G20 German presidency. The German G20 has asked them, tasked them with studying, analyzing low carbon transitions. That's one element of the theme. And of course, under the leadership of Mihir, Vikram, and Aparajit, somewhere here in this room, I can't see him, but he's the driving force behind this particular project. ORF has undertaken a two-year project to try and find ways and means of ensuring and directing greater amounts and flows of capital for both old and new infrastructure, for both low carbon infrastructure, as well as traditional social infrastructure that India needs to invest in. As I have pointed out in the past, India has two big projects concurrently unfolding. One is what I call the 20th century project, where we are completing some of our more basic infrastructure and electricity and urban and rural requirements. And on the other hand, we have a 21st century project where we are building a modern economy, a knowledge economy, a digital economy, a low carbon economy. And both of them need to be financed, and both of them need to be sustained in the decade or two ahead. Let me quickly introduce the panelists. On my extreme right is Richard, who's heading and is the lead for climate mitigation work at the OECD. And he is a key member of this particular team, and I will come to him to share with us the contours of his work and what they seek to achieve in this particular initiative. To my right is Professor Rathin Roy, who doesn't need an introduction. He's head of the National Institute of Public Finance and Policy, and is a regular author, commentator, columnist in New Delhi. And if you are his Facebook friend, he also has provocative posts that many of us enjoy digesting every morning. To my left is Geraldine Ang, one of the finest young minds in Paris, also a young leader of ORF's Asian Forum on Global Governance. She's an economist and she works on climate finance issues. To her left, Christian Kastrop, who is a macroeconomist and the director of policy studies at the OECD. And finally, Mihir Sharma, a well-known face in New Delhi, writes on everything economics. In fact, everything that he can think of, he writes on, and is a senior fellow at ORF, leading our work on financing low-carbon transitions at the Institute. So let me quickly start with Richard this evening. Richard, this OECD project, could you share with all of us the motivations and what do you seek to achieve, specifically in the timelines of the G20 and the German presidency?
Thank you very much. Essentially, we were asked by the German presidency, that is Germany this round, to tie together the growth agenda with the climate policy agenda that came out of the Paris Agreement. And the idea was to say we're now caught, for most of the countries of the G20 group, not all of them, in a low growth trap. We think we have the solutions to getting out of this low growth trap. Let's look at whether the solutions work well with the low carbon transition. And that's what we set out to do in this report. What we aim to do is to complete the work in time for inclusion of some of the recommendations in hope in how the G20 countries see this problem going forward. Exactly how officially it's going to be integrated in the G20 is, of course, Germany's issue.
And where are we in terms of the study? And are you ready to share some of your thoughts on where you seem to be heading in terms of recommendations for countries like India and perhaps even countries in Europe?
So we are more than two-thirds of the way. We came here actually to have a discussion today to hear how India thinks about those sorts of issues, knowing that there are very big differences between some of our countries and India and others in the G20 group. So that was essentially the aim. What we are trying to promote, or if you want the contours of the report, is going along two main lines. The first one is, as I said, the low growth trap and the fact that it has been a deficit in infrastructure investment among our countries for quite a while now following the crisis. If we grab this opportunity to revive public and private investment by leveraging it, we get a chance to actually revive growth at the same time. And what we're trying to say is that there is a way through smart policies to actually align and facilitate the transition to low carbon if we grab that moment and make those two things happen together. So that comes with a raft of policy messages and recommendations on what sort of instruments can best help us do this. It's fairly broad in terms of disciplines, if I may call them that. There's some economics, there's some finance sector. We look at international finance as well. We look at structural policies, macroeconomic policies, and Christian could speak to that. We also look at some of the political economy, as we sometimes call them, the issues of the transition, as it's going to impact companies, as it's going to impact workers, and as it's going to impact different countries in different ways.
Thank you, Richard. Let me come to Mihir. Let me turn to Mihir, since, Mihir, you were engaged in a day-long workshop with our colleagues from Paris. How do you see India responding to this dual challenge of both funding its more traditional infrastructure, as well as being able to sustain its remarkable growth and market-led growth in its renewables and low-carbon investments?
I think that India is in a very sort of interesting position about those two questions. Successive governments have tried to ensure that infrastructure investment from the private sector stays high. However, there continues to be, since the crisis, when a lot of people lost money, a significant debt overhang in the existing private sector companies, and the pipeline of regular investment from domestic savings into infrastructure in India is, by and large, if not broken, then at least constricted. The government has tried to make up for this, particularly in the past 3 years, by upping public investment as a part of the union budget. And it has hoped that that will clear the way, crowd in private investment into infrastructure. That has not as yet happened. We've been, investment in general has been shrinking for a while. In the last GDP numbers, it did tick up again, but there were other problems with that print, so we're not quite certain. But either way, it appears that the broad idea that private investment will recover without just through government spending itself is not working out. So we are in a position where we need to do something else. As to how the private sector, the place where the private sector is working out and has been working out is specifically in the renewable sector, where we have seen you know, the bids for unit prices for energy from for electricity from renewable energy declining steadily on the back of very, very strong market competition. The instinct would be here to just sit back and let the market operate, though I think people are now beginning to worry that there are aspects to this market that are driven by existing government policy, that there are aspects of tax holidays so far that may not continue into the future, foreseeable future for these contracts, which is a long, long foreseeable future. So it's, while it appears very rosy on the outside, there are still aspects of concern and things that we need to look into.
Mihir, we have got the power tariffs down, but the state of utilities mean that the recovery of monies owed to the power generation companies is still worrisome. And how do you respond to that?
I think that the hope currently is that if we put the finances of the utility companies themselves in a more secure footing, then they will themselves begin to pay their dues. This is a fairly reasonable point. However, it is also true that while the recent reform, the OER reform of power sector intermediaries, state electricity boards and so on and so forth, was a big step down the road towards making those entities more accountable to the market and making sure that they have a harder budget constraint, it didn't go all the way. So even if we solve the problem for the next 3-4 years, the problem is likely to come back. The problem exists because we are not able to have, so far, create power intermediaries in our various states that are insulated from political pressure from the state capital to set tariffs in a particular way. And until that changes, we are going to have a problem with intermediation. While we have a problem with intermediation, we're going to have a problem with debt. for intermediaries like discounts, and until as long as we have a problem with debt, the private sector is at some point going to find itself left out in the cold with debts owed it.
So sector reforms, in a sense, are crying for government interventions. Geraldine, how do we unlock capital? How do we unlock international capital if we are sitting in India? And how do we create more domestic sources of investments for some of these vital projects that we need to do? And I'm going to come to the two public finance gurus at the end, but let me bring Geraldine in a sense it ties into what Mihir was saying.
Yeah, thanks, Samir. That's the $1 trillion question that, you know, like you said, there's no shortage of available capital globally on capital markets and long-term asset owners. So the question is how to attract it towards, first of all, infrastructure project, second of all, low carbon infrastructure project, and third of all, because we're here in India, low carbon infrastructure project in emerging economies and other countries. So the first thing, like you said, is that there's a huge, regardless of, you know, even if the capital was flowing, you still need to improve the conditions for investment through enabling conditions domestically, right? So you need to ensure that you have a pipeline of bankable projects, and that means not just one project one by one, and for it to create a pipeline of several projects, whether in renewable energy infrastructure or public transport and other energy efficiency and other low carbon projects, you do need to address some policy misalignments within the broader investment conditions. And I won't talk about structural policies that Christian can cover, but looking at the investment conditions, you know, it's like if you wanted to target climate change action for infrastructure, you can't just look at a core climate mitigation policy action like one incentives or one renewable target or one carbon price action. You also need to look at misalignments within tax, within investment promotion and facilitation, within competition and electricity market structure, within the licensing process of infrastructure project, within, you know, for example, take the power sector. Is there a level playing field between an incumbent power utility and the newcomers, independent power producers of renewable energy in a market? And that's where, even though there is no one size fits all, we find through the preliminary conclusions of the report that there are good practices and issues across OECD and G20 countries that need to be addressed, like ensuring that transmission and distribution don't constrain the penetration of renewable while securing affordable electricity for all. So that's one issue, like you said, and there are related issues for example, innovation, public procurement. The second thing you said, how to unlock capital. Okay, so let's say that you've strengthened your domestic enabling condition, and that's core structural reforms. How do you unlock the capital flowing? And of course, there's some positive news, like Mihir mentioned that the price of auctions for renewables, for solar, has hit a record low price last week in India. So this is very positive. You know, renewable energy projects are increasingly cheaper, especially solar PV and onshore wind. And also, there's no shortage of capital, but still, you need to look at the broader global financial system and how the actors and instruments within that financial system are working. So the report is looking, for example, at possible unintended consequences of certain financial regulations within the global financial system that may constrain long-term debt finance for infrastructure projects, including renewable and other low-carbon projects. It's looking also at the need for diversification of sources of financing and instruments, tools. You know, there has been some good partnership recently, like between banks and utilities or institutional investors and international finance institutions. More can be done, you know, to increase the blended finance and the role of international finance institutions by greening their portfolio. More can be done to facilitate financing for innovation, you know, to increase the role of venture capital and private equity for such low carbon projects. But I will stop there.
You know, I want to quiz you on one aspect that you just mentioned. So what are those unintended regulations or policies that are impeding flow of, say, international commercial capital or long-term finance from, say, pension funds and insurance funds in Europe to destinations like India?
Right, so I will speak now in my personal capacity because this is very preliminary results and there's been a lot of discussion with project developers, but this is very preliminary. So you know that there's a very critical regulation that was set up after the financial crisis, including Basel III, to ensure the solvability and liquidity of a banking sector following the financial crisis. This is an incredibly important regulation that has been applied across the G20 and will be fully implemented by 2019. And there are some possible unintended consequences that by constraining and making sure that liquidity and leverage ratios are stable, which is extremely important, the long-term debt financing of bank capability might have decreased for certain long-term assets, and in particular infrastructure, a long-term asset that required debt financing. And so there are possible unintended consequences in debt financing for renewable power projects, for example. Other regulation like solvency too are too early to say because they're really not fully implemented yet, but that's an example.
Thank you. I think that brings us to the final two speakers. Let me actually start with Rathin. Rathin, you've been writing and I've heard you speaking on three kinds of finance: development finance, climate finance, public finance. And you have used a term called disciplinary ignorance amongst the economists who work these three machines. And I think we have now heard all three of them in the initial intervention. How would you say we are placed today, 2 years after signing the Paris Agreement, in terms of being able to unlock the flow of funds to both traditional and the new infrastructure?
Thank you, Samir. Well, I should just add that when I spoke of disciplinary ignorance, I did say it was intentional disciplinary ignorance.
Intentional
because it ignores a very old political economy constraint which has three dimensions. Let me possibly explicate that by saying that I see India's challenge in terms of access to long-term finance to complete our development transformation, which we want to be sustainable, as consisting of barriers to three kinds of access. Access to finance, access to technology, access to institutional capacity. In the case of finance, I think we have to face a problem of irrelevance that the G20 is an excellent manifestation of. I will forbear from commenting on the OECD since you're buying the wine. The conversation on finance does not take place in Paris, it does not take place in Nairobi, and it does not take place in the United Nations. It takes place on Wall Street, and has taken place on Wall Street for 50 years. It takes place in the city of London, well, at least until Brexit. And if you're lucky, in a few years, some of it will take place in Shanghai. This conversation on finance has to do with the core business of what the private sector does, which is to find opportunities to safely invest their money, whether short-term or long-term, in places where returns are assured without taking too much trouble over those returns. To illustrate this, if you think about economies that opened up 25 years ago, the lag between financiers being willing to go there and take advantage of opportunities in the way you would imagine capitalists would do with animal spirits was pronounced. So let us understand that that conversation does not particularly care about the things you're saying unless regulation pushes them to, notwithstanding, you know, sort of public interest statements to the contrary. So this entire conversation, the G20, if it is to be operational, I fail to see how it will be operational given the schism between these conversations on development and sustainability and the SDGs and their financing that take place in a different set of global cities and different meeting rooms than the real conversation on how finance is flowing. Parcel is of course an addition to the old infrastructure. In this context, we had New York, Paris, and now we have Basel. And the focus of Basel is entirely OECD-centric, by which I mean the focus on Basel is that these guys have had a very bad scare in the last 8 years, and their institutions are in trouble, their polities are in trouble, and therefore the Basel is there to hunker down and prevent flows of fiduciary finance to anybody. The people who could mediate this, and that's not the UN, the Bretton Woods institutions, like the OECD, are a product of the Second World War. And what we are trying to do here is marry these World War II institutions, and I think this must be Mrs. Merkel's agenda, otherwise I have absolutely no idea why this tasking happened, with a larger group of people who have voice, perhaps, but no ability to to address this challenge, which is to elide these two conversations. So in that circumstance, practically speaking, what can be done? What can be done in the G20 is for countries that understand this problem to put the problem as simply as possible. I don't know if you've been tasked with this. I think you made the point. The problem is very simple. Notwithstanding these concerns in the OECD regarding their own fragility, because these are now semi-fragile states and increasingly so, there is a simple issue. There are lots of old people who have lots of investments across the OECD, and these old people have a lifestyle which has to be funded. And existing systems to fund that lifestyle are vanishing because rates of return within the OECD are low, at least the advanced OECD. Therefore, it would follow that this money should migrate to areas where rates of return are high. The reason they're not migrating, encapsulated in the term regulatory risk, is I think fundamentally sociocultural. Sociocultural in the sense that the metrics that are used to evaluate regulatory risk are A, normative, and B, not of the order where changes in, let's say, the government of India's policy with respect to foreign direct investment are going to make a material difference. If you just look at how rating agencies rate countries, then it's a step system. And in that step system, the most important thing that matters is your per capita income. So you're permanently disadvantaged. That conversation has not been opened in the G20, despite some efforts to do so. And I don't think it will be opened because the fault lines between the OECD and non-OECD members of the G20 continue to be very real and very high for these reasons. So therefore, I think this is a very helpful report from the way you described it. The indications you gave. For if you can come up with five or six areas where you think intellectually these political fault lines can be addressed within the G20, rather than sort of saying that, good things happened in Mexico and maybe you could do them in India, then we'd be making real progress. Hearing you, I get the impression that is the intention behind the report. So I think it's an excellent idea.
Rathin, let me also quiz you on another element. There is a certain conversation in New Delhi that when new technology flows into a country such as ours, we find large technology companies making a case for opening up the market for embedding these solutions into the economic structures. But we don't necessarily see the same technology companies being backed by their bankers. And they rely largely on onshore financial solutions.
You talk about domestic.
Domestic. And have we reached, in many ways, has India reached a ceiling on the capacity to underwrite many of these technology transformations? Or do you think if we were to make reforms at home in terms of our own markets, we can probably free up more capital?
Yes, of course we could. I mean, there's a lot of scope for us to do it. And in fact, oddly enough, in the sort of so-called bad old days, that is what the state did with very effectively by investing in the IITs and agricultural research. So many of the innovations that actually raised growth in India were based on state-led interventions in technology, which were then put at the service of the private sector. It has now become either unfashionable or, I think, considered inappropriate for the state to think of investing in R&D and technology to scale to sort of lead the efforts made by private sector companies. A very good example of that is that most of the R&D that happens, for example, now in the internet space that brings in young entrepreneurs, the most successful entrepreneur from one of our best management institutes who has invested in research and technology is investing in food delivery platforms. And that is because returns to that technology are certain, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But the ability to push to make investments, persistent investments in R&D, forget sustainable development, even in areas like pharmaceuticals, is now petering out. And there I think we can do it, but then the attitude of the state would have to change. Mm.
So let me come to Christian. You've heard the previous interventions. And as someone who studies public finance, as someone who's leading the policy studies at OECD, what could be some of those easy wins in the period leading up to 2020 when the commitments of Paris begin to kick in? So we still have 3 years, and what could be done by certainly the G20 countries and some other as well, in terms of preparing for that transformation that we seek?
This is the issue. So what we really tried to do with this project and what the Germans asked us, because there was the idea to also to bring, say, the out of the environmental niche and really to put it to the forefront of finance and economics ministers. And so this is to combine the two issues, so striving for a low carbon economy and a low carbon society, also in line with a high growth society and high growth economics. So, and this is what we try to match, and this would make it interesting also for both parts, because we can then show we can really reach a low carbon society and we can also reach high growth, which brings you out of the low growth trap. And this is what we are trying to pursue with this project, because I think, to be honest, if such a project of climate change, which is about a generational dimension, if you will put this forward, you really need all stakeholders to act with one force. And this is what we tried, and this is what the crisis, in a sense, delivered us in the very long run, or in the long run now up to 2020, it's medium term already, but it will feed into a long-term issue. This is about, we really have the possibilities. So there is a kind of a unique moment for a lot of countries now to take care of additional investment, which will bring you also on a high growth path. So you mentioned it already, a lot of economies have net public investment for a long while. I know it's not true for India, but it's true for a lot of other societies. And I think we have the unique chance to lock in the relatively low interest rates following out of the crisis, also in line with a unconventional monetary policy, which was always the first line of defense for macroeconomic policies. We can use that. So a lot of countries have fiscal space. A lot of countries can use fiscal policies, macroeconomic, macrofiscal policies to go for a high growth strategy. And this is mainly also linked to infrastructure at the beginning, at the very beginning. And then I think the interesting aspect would be that this macroeconomic response would feed into higher potential growth in the long run, with high quality investment, infrastructure investment, and it would feed in also to higher productivity. And this is of course true for a lot of economies. Right now it's more for advanced economies, because you see quickly aging societies right now already have the need where to create the growth for the old, where to create the chances for the young generation. You have to do it out of, say, total factor productivity. Economists know this is a kind of a strange residuum. What you cannot measure on productivity is total factor productivity, and this is why it's so important to invest and to make it happen. But this is only the starting position, to have this macroeconomic push, and then of course this would lead also phasing in with structural reforms, also with institutional reforms. This would then phase in, and then you can think about a lot of additional things. Structural reforms already been mentioned on the finance side, but also on the product market side, on the labor side. And it will also encourage investment, for instance, in so soft infrastructure like education infrastructure, R&D. This is already mentioned. And in our modeling exercise for this G20 project, we are trying really to show, and we are quite, how you say, confident that we really can show it, that if you go for this scenario to use an intelligent macroeconomic policies for some years, locking in the low interest rates, then phasing in structural reforms of all kind, also reorientation of the public budgets on the expenditure side, on the revenue side, to a more pro-growth productivity thing, then you can have a lot of good results. And this will also feed into what is also a very important point for the OECD. This is the issue that everybody in the society really has an advantage out of that, so that really the inclusiveness of the societies can also be strengthened and across the board. And I think this is what we're trying to do, and this is the entire idea, to combine a high growth strategy with a low growth carbon society.
Low carbon. We've now had some opening comments from each of the panelists, and I'm going to actually now ask them to jump in when they want to. This is, we are now in a nice Indian setting. Don't wait for formality of me turning to you. Just come in. But I want to now ask you all to address two important issues, I think, which we grappled with a bit during the day. The first is the inevitable movement of people to urban centers in countries such as India, so urbanization and urban spaces, because they will implicate many systems, including the low carbon transition that we are speaking about. Also implicit in this movement is the challenge of employment and a new political economy that will emerge both in the city spaces as well as in the polity. The second issue I think we should, take on head on is the newfound appetite in Europe for coal and the continued dependence of India on coal. I think there is now a certain, and with the recent elections in a country across the Atlantic, you might see a certain degree of vigor in this, in the fossil fuel sector. I think we need to confront that as well. The state is back. Big companies might be back. I'm not sure how long the period will last, but it might be disruptive enough. So we need to start thinking about it. Let me start with Mihir. Mihir, let's start with urban spaces. And I think this is something that India has the advantage in a sense. It is not locked in yet, and we have enough space to be creative here. So how do you scope this challenge or opportunity? And what are some of the policy ideas that the government of India must think about?
Well, I think the question of urbanization in India is a fraught one, because on the one hand, technically, you keep on hearing this, right? We're still a rural country, et cetera, et cetera. That may not be true, even if you say that people aren't, even the people who aren't moving to the cities are moving to their local highway, and those strips of land are becoming like cities, all right, or like towns. So urbanization in place is happening even when migration has become impossible. If our cities feel full, if there's no employment there, people recognize nevertheless there's no employment in the village in which they grew up. So there is an attempt to urbanize in place or close by. So it is true that we haven't built our cities yet, but we're living like we have. We live in cities, etc. Already, except without the cities. In other words,
except without urban services.
Yeah. In other words, we are in danger of becoming a very, very large slum. All right. And if you've seen large parts of Indian highways, it can begin to feel like that. Unplanned growth without clear property rights, without clear access to services, and without the definition, in fact, without the legal definition that goes with being a properly recognized city or a town. So it's already happening whether we like it or not, and the government has woken up fairly late to the fact that it is happening. For decades, we have wanted to, by and large, keep people in villages, and the thought that people moving would want to leave villages is seen as somehow a bad thing. Right? It means that they're not earning enough in villages, and we should be paying them somehow to stay in villages rather than incentivizing or easing their move to cities. Right, so the position that we have now taken is essentially, all right, we are going to see people move to cities, we have to create some infrastructure for them, we have to provide some services for them. Unfortunately, the policy response over the past 12 years or so has not been really up to the mark. The last government's Jawaharlal Nehru Urban Renewal Mission and this government's Smart Cities and Amrut things, which are basically, they're similar in concept except for minor tweaks to the Smart Cities idea, essentially are shortcuts for the real problem. And I think some of that emerged from today's discussion as well. The real problem is that you need to be able to empower cities to create long-term plans for their future, to ensure that they have steady and reliable revenue streams with which they can make their own investments, and that they have the capacity to make these plans and to implement them, within the local administration. We haven't really gone far enough to solving these problems. The smart cities idea, for example, while a very good one, is a trickle in terms of the amount of money that it is devoting, that it is likely to spend. The shortcuts, the ideas that are being mooted as part of the smart cities plan are basically shortcuts. It's sort of, instead of reconstructing a new and proper public transport system, can I put GPS in my buses? Of course these are helpful. It might reduce things by 5%, cost by 5%, 7%, but it is not what building cities really involves. So we have a vast amount of work to do in terms of actually understanding the notion of building cities. There are some cities that are doing this. You know, maybe New Raipur, maybe Amravati, that are starting from scratch. But we need 100 Amravatis and we're not doing that.
Richard, I think your study does grapple with this particular aspect.
Yeah, we do, but I wanted to speak to the coal issue that you raised in second, so if I may. It won't be a surprise to any of you who've looked at scenarios coming out of the IPCC, the global scenarios that are compatible with the Paris Agreement goals of the temperature increase not going above 2 degrees, that there is no long-term future for coal under this in this picture. And I stress on the long-term, and this is definitely not going to happen at the same time in every country, we understand that. But you made the point about the renewed appetite for coal in the EU, and I'd like to maybe dispel a fallacy on this. It's important to recognize that EU has taken a specific policy to address the issue of industry and power generation, and that is to have a cap and trade system, as we call it. It so happens that the emissions are now very, very much below the cap, and so it allows for entities who have, you know, excess access to emission permits to use whatever technology they wish. So if they want to burn coal for now, they're allowed to do that under the EU emission trading system. The problem we have with that is that it might trigger some reinvestment in coal. And that, to us, is unsustainable in Europe. We believe it's going to lead to what we call a stranding of assets, that is, money that's going to go into long lifetime plans that are not going to be recovering their capital, and that would be a problem. So you do see countries like the UK where they say, actually, you cannot invest in new coal. Even though there is already a constraint with the EU emission trading system, they say, on top of that, you do not invest in new coal power generation. So that's an element that's important to keep in mind. What we're looking for now is how the shift away from coal is going to happen, you know, sooner or later in different places. We see it happening in some cases because there's competition coming from renewables. And then the question comes is whether the environment, the policy environment, allows for that competition to happen and to actually let the better win. We also understand there are countries with extremely fast and unmet demand for electricity, and that you need to use the resources at hand to best satisfy that. And I wanted to pick up just on the point that Rathin Roy made on this institutional capacity, and on the point that Mihir just made about, you know, planning cities and so on. There's one element that comes out of our report that relates to this odd thing called public procurement. Mm-hmm. And we identify in our countries as a... I've been cut off, I've gone too long.
I think it's just we. Yeah. Our plugs okay. No, that was on a solar powered.
It was on a, yeah, intermittency. And the point I wanted to make is that this is eventually a great tool that could be used to actually create lead markets in low carbon technologies for specific industries, including for infrastructure related technologies. So we're looking at materials like cement and steel and how public procurement could drive innovation there. So we're looking towards that. But the one thing we miss in all our countries, and that's one of these investments that we need to make, is the institutional capacity for the public procurement offices to actually be able to make those calls. And that's an investment that we call on for long-term success of our strategy, because if governments keep spending the money the way they've been spending it under a high-carbon, unconstrained scenario, we're not going to get there. So I'm fully after the institutional capacity case here.
Thank you, Richard. So I was actually, I used the term Europe and not EU, and I was talking about some members within the community and not the entire EU. And you know who I'm referring to. Of course, the point exactly was what you identified it, that if we allow it to happen, you are first locking in, which means you're depriving my ability to set up coal plants here, which I may need, because you are grabbing my space of coal. And second, you are going to destroy the particular momentum of institutional change that had gained momentum over the past 15 years to move away from that particular form of energy generation. And I think those are two. So we have opened up both urbanization and coal, and the curious thing called government procurement. And I want Rathin to come in.
Thank you. Can I just start by talking about coal? I think this is excellent. I think there is no case whatsoever for OECD countries to be investing a single dollar in coal. And in fact, by government fiat, you should be shutting down all your coal plants tomorrow. And that would solve my problem, which is that there is no way, and I'm so glad you recognize that, we can meet the unmet demand for electricity in the medium term without increasing our coal output, which my power minister celebrates every morning in his tweets, at the same time as he celebrates the success of our renewables mission. And that is how it is going to be. So if the rest of the advanced world, which has completed its development transformation, stops investing in this terribly polluting technology, which is going to be stranded in the future, then I think that's a very good thing. I think that the stranding in my own country will perhaps take a little longer, quite longer, because you know relative prices here are different, and you know as long as coal is non-tradable, I do not see India or any other country like India, all of Africa, acceding to any kind of global attempt to tinker with these relative prices. So I think that's a virtuous solution. I do hope your report argues that forcefully. Shut down coal in every developed country, and let us modestly increase our coal consumption and do it as cleanly as possible. And we can talk about that in the discussion, how we can do it cleanly as possible. All right, the second point I wanted to make is that it's very interesting. I think we're all becoming, I don't know whether to be happy or sad, I think I'm a little happy about this. While the world is turning politically conservative, we are all becoming socialists. I see in this attempt to sort of specify what is going to happen to relative prices and how to change them and how to allocate money, a wonderfully almost technovite, reminds me of the USSR, attempt to bring in some form of Langeleiner central planning. And that concerns me because, you know, one lesson we have learned in this country very bitterly is that people are smart. We learned it recently with demonetization too. And they will react. Mr. Trump will learn this lesson too. I often say you cannot prevent people from emigrating if they want to emigrate, whatever walls you build. It's going to be very difficult, even if you try and shoot them. In the same way, we have to be very conscious that countries and will actually then react to policies that are being imposed in ways that may not be anticipated. So any attempt by the G20 to try and sculpt the world towards a harmonious outcome will come up against the same political economy barriers that I was referring to earlier. When we can find harmonious outcomes like shut down coal in the rich world so that Africa and India can increase their coal production a bit, I think we will have no difficulty, but there are other areas. On the macroeconomics, I mean, there is a genuine issue here. The, well, at least three countries in Europe got the IMF to rewrite their rules for them. You see, when we had trouble in 1991, or when Ethiopia has trouble, or when anybody has trouble, the international financial community would say, we must do a debt sustainability analysis. And then they would have certain parameters. And if you failed that exam, the IMF would impose conditionalities. But oh dear, how do you possibly impose conditionalities on EU member states? So what the IMF did was gave those countries a systemic exemption. I haven't forgotten. A systemic exemption. And that meant you don't have to pass this exam. We will give you the money. We will be okay with conditionalities. And then when the crisis was over, and the G20 has been very good for European countries in crisis, I see on my table the finance ministry asking for some advice, saying the IMF now wants to withdraw the systemic exemption for anybody else. Now, the point I'm making is this kind of peripatetic altering of rules, which has been accepted in the past by countries because they have not had the ability to disengage from them, is just simply not going to happen again. It is not going to happen again. And therefore, if the intention is to set in place an expansionary macroeconomic policy in advanced countries so that their growth goes up, I think it is palpably obvious to the emerging economies that that would defeat the very purpose of the project of ensuring high global growth by doing what all economists know, which is to let capital flow to places where it earns higher rates of return and not use fiscal policy to tinker
with, the flow.
With that global market process. Something that I have been told all my adult working life until 3 years ago when the crisis happened in other places. Perhaps all this will be irrelevant when the border tax comes in. Perhaps all this will be irrelevant when Mr. Trump, you know, sort of blows up the US fiscal deficit. But if we are going to do this in what purports to be a rules-based framework like the G20, I think it's very important, this is feedback really for the report, to understand that these messages will not be straightforwardly accepted as being in the common good, because there are trade-offs, and it would be best perhaps to acknowledge these trade-offs and perhaps reason that these can be resolved. Thank you.
Christian, you want to come in? So now you have four issues to respond to. You can pick and choose: urbanization, coal, the misuse of a rule-based system for the benefit of some, and the curious thing called government procurement. So there are four issues that you can pick and choose from.
So let me first come back on the fiscal rule. Even if this you can talk about hours of that. So I still think yes, indeed. I think in over the crisis time, you can all the system of incentives which have been created upfront to the fiscal crisis for stabilizing the monetary union in the Eurozone, I think have been somehow slashed. I agree with that and. There is an issue there which you can discuss, but I still think the entire idea is not yet dead. And I think the European Union and the Eurozone, they may have another effort to re-stabilize it again. There are several issues at stake. Probably you can only get the, say, incentive-based system with a so-called no bailout clause back again if you rethink the issue of debt restructuring. Let me be, this is my personal position. So this is not an OECD position, but this is where we probably, the Europeans have to talk about. And they did not manage, I guess, the euro crisis super well. So it was a kind of an, so acting from day to day and not really acting in a kind of a good framework which tries to help the problematic countries and which also tries to safeguard the main principles. This does not mean that as a pragmatic as I am, I would always go for a certain pragmatism and we should not make a dogma out of a certain rule. A dogma, fiscal rules are made for a certain time and if you should, probably it's not about writing a new book of something, so it's about looking whether a fiscal rule can solve existing problems in stabilizing a European Union which has no economics union, which has no fiscal union, but fortunately it's now at least getting a banking union. And the other things are on work. So let me, this is about this rules issue. Of course, I know probably we are entering times, and this goes back to your different political economy, where people say, I don't care about structures, I don't care about global governance, I will strike deals with my major friends and something like that. And this, in fact, makes me a bit, I fear it a bit, because I think institutions like the G20, like the IMF, like the OECD, it's all out of the Bretton Woods situation after the Second World War. I think they are really, really necessary. And I have the strong, if I can make that point, I really, really think global governance is not dead. On contrary, and I think we have to maintain whatever happens in some countries west of the Atlantic and whatever may happen in some European countries in the near future, we should really maintain. And if some push is lost in the western part of the Atlantic and in some parts of Europe, I think India should really take the lead now, battling for that. So I think we have to strengthen the institutions of global governance, and India should really play a very forceful and important role. So,
Geraldine.
Thanks. So maybe I want to take the urbanization issue.
Thailand, right?
No, not Thailand, India.
India, okay.
So Mihir, you talked about the need to empower cities, and there's so much that can be said on the urban governance challenge and in Indian cities with the urbanization trend, but every city across the world, you know, if you take New York City, if you're the New York City mayor and you want to reduce congestion and private vehicle, you have to deal not only with the New York City citizens and all the lobby associations, but New York City State, New Jersey State, and Pennsylvania State. So you have to deal with a tri-state area that's the size of a little country in Europe. So this challenge is everywhere. But I think maybe I want to take off my economist hat and talk about the challenge, beyond the challenge, the opportunity, the huge opportunity that I've heard from today's discussion during the workshop for urbanization. That I think for India, urbanization represents that huge opportunity to build its identity and social contract and inclusiveness to integrate both poor and wealthy business, civil communities. And it's true that, of course, this will require government intervention. This will require empowerment at the local level. This will require stakeholder engagement because, you know, if you have to incorporate mixed development with commercial, urban public transport, you have to deal with clusters, you have to deal with integration of different communities, you have to deal with higher density, of course. But I think it's a fascinating issue when we are increasingly looking at globalization. And at the Paris Agreement, it was very surprising how much urban and local authorities took more vocal state in the action on climate change, and that's because at city level, I think there's no better level where the co-benefits between climate action, growth, and social inequalities fit better. You know, traffic congestion in Delhi, you know everywhere the cost that traffic congestion bears on everyone's life. And if you reduce traffic congestion, you also reduce local air pollution, and you reduce the cost on health, and you also reduce greenhouse gas emissions. So there's huge benefits, I think, and I think that's where you need a discourse that goes beyond the core economist hat to talk to the narrative for the citizens, and that's where I think Mihir's point on empowering the city officials, but also empowering the city citizens might be a critical one, because, you know, I think if you take the level of a village, of course you have participation of stakeholders. So if you take the urban, even more so, you should have the participation of stakeholders.
So we have around 20 minutes left. I would like to bring you all into this conversation. I would request you to identify yourself, not necessarily make an intervention, but pose a question. I can see two hands or four hands. If you can ask the question to a specific panelist, do identify him. Otherwise, we'll just pick and choose the ones we want to answer.
My name is Dr. Sharma. I had been with Planning Commission looking after low carbon economy for the country. I just have a few comments, actually. The G20 countries account for about 80 to 82% of energy consumption, while top four, China, US, Russia, and India, it accounts for about 50%. But these four countries still intend to reduce the emission intensity of GDP. I've been one of the members of G20 Clean Energy Ministerial, along with Dr. Stephen Chu. And I believe that renewable energy may not contribute much, but reduced per capita energy consumption globally, as well as the energy efficiency, maybe to some extent really help in low carbon economy. Now, if we just have a look at some data on the renewable energy, in 2011, globally the total investment on renewable energy was $285 billion. It had been hovering around $270 to $260 billion. Of course, last year it had gone up to $290 billion. So renewable energy, I don't know, I mean, to what extent it's really going to help to a greater extent. It's basically, you see, we really want to move towards a low carbon trajectory for the future generations, not to inhale the carbon. It has to be the attitude of the people across the globe needs to change the way energy is used. Maybe, I mean, to some extent, we need to use a lower quantum of energy per capita. And the coal, oil, gas, this may not
so really his point make is consumption. Difference. His point is, let's
and how
about
Germany
consumption.
Is really so, going so to have on this.
Yeah, thanks. The gentleman there.
AK Jain, urban planner. I heard with a lot of interest the five presentations, very good, brilliant. Since 1972, when we had the Stockholm Environment Conference, we have come a long way, created the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, enacted the Environment Pollution Control Acts, and a lot of environment departments, forest departments created. Yeah. Now the question is that we have been having a very statutory or maybe legal approach, and as we are discussing today, very economic approach to the whole issue of low carbon transition. Low carbon transition, I think principles are known to everyone very well, and India has done very well in this evolution of the principles. But it is related with the ground reality, with the geography, with the culture. So the point is that it will not succeed, it will not happen if we don't have a strong urban planning framework for low carbon transition, so that it relates with the geography and the culture. Thank you.
Okay, so, General Chopra.
Thank you. Okay, I'm not an economist, but I think I'm a thinking man. I'll start with my last point first. Samir, you talked about urbanization. We can discuss this till the cows come home. The simple answer, according to me, is like the mainstream to the Northeast, we don't ask the Northeast to come to the mainstream, but we take it to them. Similarly, urbanization, let's take it to rural India and see how it works. My actual intervention was growth and investment, which has been under the rubric of globalization. That seems to have changed now, and we're talking of deglobalization. I want to know, how does this affect India? Now, as far as India is concerned, we want rapid growth, make in India, et cetera, we're looking for investments, in my view. We're not seriously looking at low carbon transition. What the youth in this hall also wants is rapid growth. And finally, being a software man, the information technology investments from India are not going to go westwards, particularly to the US, with Trump's new attitude. In other words, we draw investments in India and look at opportunities here, which is not a wrong perception at all. And finally, G20, will it be USA versus the rest? Thank you, Chairman.
Add to this question. I think the point that might be of interest for some of you is that how does this new move to take back the reins of governance to your national capitals implicate both the efficacy and the effectiveness of the G20, the relevance of the G20, and are we really undertaking this particular exercise which will have limited appeal to some of the big countries today? There was another, yes sir, please. Hey, can we take just one more and then I'll come back to all of you, please.
I am Major General Dr. Ashok Mehta. You see, it's pretty clear that in our context, the context of India, the financing has to come greatly from the private sector, the corporate sector. There are limitations of the government and the public investments. Now, insofar as the corporate investment is concerned, their primary objective is to create wealth for the stakeholders. So unless there's a win-win situation, they are not likely to come out very much to invest. So therefore, the fiscal and monetary policies is one. But second, I have a very small suggestion that we have a mandatory CSR investment by the corporate. So why couldn't this be part of the CSR investment, which is mandatory?
Okay. Good. Let me come back to the panelists and let me start with Mihir. He's been away from the mic for very long. Mihir, and let me add a quick point. Are we entering an era, or were we trying to achieve carbon socialism? Because that was one of the terms used here. That, in a sense, if we want to achieve carbon equity, everyone has the same carbon space. We also want to achieve the same carbon solutions. We also want to impose the same carbon policies.
Well, I think then we will suffer the fate of all socialisms, which is that we will, we'll be chasing, an elusive future, an illusion of a delightful future, while our present sort of crumbles into dust. But the sad fact is that, there is a however much we may say over and over again, it's unfair. And we've said it over and over again, and we're still saying it. India has, to its credit and to this government's credit, moved on from saying things are unfair. Things are still unfair, but we're not making such a point of...
We're not waiting for justice.
We're not waiting for justice. So carbon socialism is dead. The question is, where will the carbon market come from, and how can you have light touch carbon regulation? So if we want to create a carbon third way, all right, what will it look like? And I think that's the world that we're in right now.
And do you want to respond to any of these questions on urbanization?
I think on urbanization, you're absolutely right. It's about changing attitudes, and it's about attitudes both at personal and institutional. I think the interesting question for me was the question about deglobalization and the G20. And I would actually, let me sound heretical and say the G20 never actually took any power away from capitals. All right. The G20 was always a bunch of capital cities getting in a room, and when they discovered they agreed about something, which was rarely, it happened. So when the capitals agreed that they should spend lots of money to get out of a financial crisis, everyone spent lots of money. When the capitals disagreed about how their central banks should be behaving, there was no coordination, right? So when you can get the capitals to agree, then the G20 works. So it wasn't, unlike a lot of other institutions, it was never actually taking that much power away from capitals. And even here we see it's an attempt to persuade other capitals. Right. This is, I think, this project is an attempt for the German presidency to say, to sit down with the 19 other capitals and capital cities and say, guys, this is in your interest as well. So I think that then it might work.
Richard.
Yeah, a number of interesting points there. One, I fully agree that energy efficiency is at the core of this issue, and that the best way we can facilitate the growth in renewable in the energy mix is by actually lowering our overall demand. That's pretty obvious. It's just working with volume. So. And there's going to be also a behavioral change, we hope, attached to the low carbon transition. But that's not something that politicians are good at either projecting, we fall into socialism, or pushing for. There has to be changes in preferences. Obviously, we see some of that happening in the north, in the OECD countries. We'll have to see how much that drives actually transformations. A point maybe on mandatory CSR. We have seen countries where, when there was mandatory CSR imposed, there was actual better behavior on the side of companies who were exposed to that, that they actually took this seriously. However, the one thing we want to have first is appropriate disclosure of carbon footprints of companies and their climate risks as well. That's a way to start, so that investors start seeing something that they were not paying attention to. Whether that's mandatory or not, that's a decision for countries to take. Maybe a quick point on socialism again. I mean, the Paris Agreement spirit is exactly the opposite. It's about the build-up from the bottom up of nationally determined contributions, and clearly India's contribution is different from Germany's contribution, which is different from the UK's and so on and so forth. The way I look at it is that we have to manage a transition from a world where we have more or less competition that was unconstrained on CO2 to a world where we say there is this constraint, and what we are doing now is a planned transition for some of our countries to that low carbon competition world, which is quite challenging because there are lots of things that need to change, lots of political economy issues to solve, lots of exit strategies to be planned, and that's going to be the challenge. But what we're hoping for is this light touch approach to it in the end, which is, you know, challenging for policymakers because they'd like to put lots of things on the table. So, but I'll leave it at that for now. Thank you.
Rathin.
Thank you. Well, I think there are three questions I'd like to touch. I want to make a brief point on urbanization. You know, many years ago, and this is a problem which is manifest in India and let's say France, but India is in a rather worse situation to deal with it. Urbanization is about the interaction of elites, not just economic elites, economic and social elites, with non-economic and social elites, you know, just like in a village. And I used to work a few years ago in a country called Sierra Leone. In Sierra Leone, the elites had, it's going to sound familiar to some of you who come from smaller towns in India, had BMWs and Audis, but they had no roads. So the way I tried to sell the idea that perhaps a reduction in corruption in aid invested in roads would be good for the children of elites was by saying that, wouldn't you like to drive your BMWs in Kuala Lumpur? Don't you want to see your roads become like Kuala Lumpur? That social contract is very fragile, and countries deal with it in different ways. It's your headquartered in Paris. Paris beyond the peripheric is not the Paris that I live in when I come to Paris. Right? But in our country, we have this problem that the elites do not actually see an incentive in investing mm-hmm. in the public instruments that are required for urbanization. But if you were able to sell the idea a little more differently, saying that public transport, good public transport, would actually enable you to get cheaper household labor, perhaps you could come up with some sort of political settlement that we work with. As long as that does not happen, cities will constantly be places where elites try to privatize at great detriment to themselves. Okay. On the G20 and deglobalization, to add to what Mihir said, there is a partial problem here. I'm a socialist. Full disclosure, I'm a socialist.
You're Indian, so let's go, carry on.
In India, I appear to be treated as extreme right wing, but actually I'm a socialist. And What I have learned from experimental socialism is that partial socialism does not work. It is quite interesting that we say unselfconsciously that let's have global governance with the IMF, the G20. These are not egalitarian institutions, or the OECD. These are not inclusive institutions. But the moment you mention the only multilaterally inclusive institution in the world, people switch off. And there is no more disturbing example of this than the recent fracas on who should be looking at the multilateral taxation cooperation system. The idea that the IMF or the OECD should do it is patently nonsense, since these are by no means representative of most of humanity, neither of these, both in terms of voting power and in terms of membership. So we must be very careful when we make this plea for global government, because we have been part of the problem. So this deglobalization that is happening is not happening just because of Trump. Trump is a consequence of an attempt to sort of gerrymander the globalization process. A concrete way in which the G20 could do this, in the context of the problems I was raising for finance, you know what I'm going to say. Look at the history of trade. What we did with trade was we set up GATT, which has now morphed into WTO. Everybody came to GATT, everybody argued in GATT, GATT was painful, GATT caused setbacks, GATT took, but if you look back at GATT and WTO over 50 years, did it work in terms of its grand meta objective, which is to improve global governance in trade and open up trade? Of course it did. We need something like that in finance, but I do not see the G20 regrettably showing that sort of imagination to propose a global standing council on finance. Final point I want to make is on CSR. CSR is just a tax. I mean, ask yourself the question that if companies are required to give 2% of their profits to some activities, why can't the government just take that and do it? Right? So it's actually an optical illusion. And in our country, it is therefore subject to the same demands. So there's an education lobby out there who wants me to put CSR in education. There's a health lobby that wants me to do it. There's a sanitation lobby that wants me to do it. There's a nutrition lobby that wants me to do it. And the 2% will only go so far. So I don't think there's any skin in the game in CSR.
Geraldine.
Yeah, maybe just to, I was going to talk about CSR anyway, but Rathin, since you're saying that, maybe I can take a counterpart view that, for me, I was going to say, I think CSR is everything but a requirement, because the perspective that has been taken in the past year and a half since the Paris Agreement from the private sector, corporate sector, but especially the financial sector, has been to recognize that CSR and climate disclosure and climate risk is first and foremost a risk management issue for the portfolio assets of financial companies and the corporate sector, which means that it is not about taking into account the public sector interest or moral issue or taxation of benefits. It's about saying how much in your portfolio, you know, you're accounting for risk of construction, you're accounting for risk of policy uncertainty, but are you accounting for the climate risk associated with physical risk of your infrastructure assets, with policy risk, with transition risk, in the transition? And I think the best speech that I can recommend was from the governor of the UK Central Bank, Mark Carney, in September last year, that talked about the tragedy of the erosion and those transition risk. And it was solely to the insurance companies in the UK telling them, careful, in your risk management strategy, you are mistaken and you're forgetting one risk. And all the institutional investors, insurance companies, pension funds, that have taken voice publicly to commit to climate risk disclosure in the past year and a half and before, are acknowledging that this is for the sole interest of portfolio optimization. So this is a really important point that I want to flag. And I think, like Richard mentioned, voluntary climate disclosure schemes could highly encourage factoring those risks in the portfolio management of financial sectors and broader corporate sector.
Thank you, but I think there is a conflation with corporate governance and good corporate governance in CSR, and I think you have kind of traversed both. You've traversed both parts of the corporate boardroom responsibilities. Christian, you have the last word amongst the panelists, and I'll say a few things thereafter, and we'll close and we'll go for dinner.
Okay, I will start with a rather fundamental point. I think whatever it takes, I think we have really global challenges, and one of the, I think, really upfront global challenge, even if we don't see it everywhere and at every time, I think is climate change, and climate change also related to whatever we do on fossil energy sources, they will end somewhere, sometime, and then we don't have them. And nuclear, as we have it right now, also is relatively climate friendly, but poses other very, very large risks. So either we live in this together or we die in this together. So I think this is really a very fundamental issue. So let me put it like this, and therefore, how we see, we have a global challenge, we have also to solve it globally. So in deglobalization, this is the second point I want to make. Deglobalization is happening, and of course it's happening in some areas of the world, for instance in China, for some good reasons, because China has to rebalance its economy. This will have the loosening of some global value chains, so they will do more in their own country. So there is a bit of this trade problem we now face. So trade is so low. Part of that trade issue is due to, for sure, to China rebalancing. This is good to have it, because then China will be a more stable factor in the world economy for the years to come, not adding to another global challenge. Maybe there are other global challenges in China, I won't touch on them. So, but there is another issue, of course, if protectionism takes charge. And if protectionism takes charge as follow-up of populism, I think then we are really risking not only lower growth everywhere, and lower growth will mean less income, less jobs, and probably less opportunities to battle climate change. So there is an issue there, and I think open societies, free and fair trade, I think is still what we really going to need. And then point to me here, yes, G20 is a very, very imperfect thing. Yes, the IMF and the OECD are very, very imperfect institutions. But these are institutions we really have to build on. You see, all these institutions, even if they are 50, 70 years old, right now, 65, I think they are still a bit babies or youngsters. So I think we should not say they're obsolete. Maybe there are better ones for to come. But I think we should still think about putting our global institutions for challenge, for tackling global challenges. We really should empower them as we should empower cities in India. I leave it with that.
Thank you, Christian. Let me conclude by picking on four words that I've heard in the last interventions. The first was populism. And I think Mihir touched on it. Mihir was right. In many ways, we had a prime minister in India who used his popularity to embed renewable energy ambitions, climate change ambitions, and shift India's historic position of being the global trade union to being the deal maker in Paris. In a sense, if you saw the post-Paris letter or communication from the G77, they acknowledged China, they did not acknowledge India because they saw India breaking rank and seeking a global agreement. But populism does not detract from climate action. That's the point I'm making. The issue is that if you can embed climate action within the popular narrative, you can still see progress. The question is that at the federal level, can we also have similar popular leaders who can change the way cities are organized, big transportation is invested in, and consumption and other elements that will implicate climate mitigation is responded to. So populism is important, and populism can be used. It is not necessarily a negative. That's the first point I'm making. The second is climate is a huge challenge. That's what Christian said. I do not agree climate is a huge challenge. I have not seen any indication from the global community that climate is a big challenge. I don't see any signs of it. Unfortunately, I've always been the other side of the teller, so I've never played with money, but I still look at, I follow the money to see what big problems are. In 2009, 20 global leaders met in London and announced $5 trillion to save the global ecosystem, the financial ecosystem. 6 months later, 107 global leaders met in Copenhagen, and they were unwilling to commit anything for climate action. In fact, they said, we will commit $100 billion 11 years later. So climate was a $100 billion problem. 11 years later, the financial crisis was a $5 trillion problem immediately. Countries price problems differently, and policies emanate from how they price problems. I don't think we have a global consensus on how to price this problem. So I think we need to start talking about how to price climate. The third issue that I've heard is on consumption. And I think it's important. I think Richard made that point. We are not good at behavior change. You know, there's an important statistic, 5 years old, but that was a paper I was writing at that time. I lost track of the matter because we lost the battle. while the year when the global community committed $100 billion for 11 years later to combat climate change, I got statistics from the US industries, aviation, the high pollution industries, aviation, tourism, auto, construction, real estate, and commercial solutions. These five sectors spent $1.2 trillion on making us consume more, on selling consumption to people. They won, because those sectors have still not gone down. We are marginally attacking 25% of the industrial challenge that remains. That's the only thing. And the last point, and I was mentioning this to my colleagues from OECD, and that's food for thought. A Brazilian colleague post-Paris said to us that, you know, I was telling my colleagues here before the evening started that, you know what, you tell me that the scope of the problem is so big that your sovereign budgets can't help the emerging world. You also tell us that your markets and your private sector is beyond your control. You can't force them to invest and you can't force them to direct money in certain regions. But you still believe that you have enough power that you can tell me what to do. And therefore, you tell us the policy solutions and you don't talk to your investors and you don't talk to your companies. So I think it's time we start talking to ourselves back home, both in India and in Europe. We start talking to the larger constituencies that we have let loose. I think governments have surrendered to the market. And sometimes I think we need to have a frank conversation with them as well. So thank you very much for joining us this evening.